Hallelujah, praise the Lord. manifest your power, O Lord. Father, give us the revelation and knowledge of your word. In the name of Jesus, let your word break away. Every shield blocking the word of God in every heart, break them away, Father, and let your word penetrate through the body and the spirit and their soul and divide them into parts. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you because you are Lord. Glory to your name, Lord. I pray that you create a landing place for your word in the heart of the man and woman as the listening, in the name of Jesus. Holy Spirit of God, have your way. Take control. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Glory to the message that the Lord had for us today. Man shall not live by bread alone. Man shall not live by bread alone. Man shall not live by bread alone. Deuteronomy chapter 8, 1 to 6 and 12 to 20. The same Deuteronomy chapter 8, 1 to 6 and 12 to 20. Living by bread alone. We know what bread is. We know what bread is. And we know how to live is. So bread, as far as we are concerned, human being, we live by bread, we live by food. So when the Bible says bread, it means by food. You know, bread is like the fuel to the body of human being. Just like we put fuel in the cars. So we put bread in our body. That's the best thing they could use for food in those days of the Bible. So we put our bread in our body to survive. So in other words, this topic is telling us that we do not need, human beings do not need only bread, only food to survive. The life of survival is not based on bread. It's not based on provision. Our survival is not only on provision. Our happiness is not only on provision. Our happiness is not only about what God can do or what He has done for us. This is not the purpose of our salvation. The reason why we came to Christ, that Christ saved us, is not for us to receive. It's for us to give. The Bible says, for God's love so loved the world that He did what? He gave. God has called us to give our life as a sacrifice, a living sacrifice that will follow Him from now to the end. We are not in the church to receive. Our purpose of being in the church is not to receive. It's not to get. It's not to have. It is good to receive. I'm not saying it's not good to have a hope to receive from God. But what I'm saying is that we should not have a driving force to say, it's either God provides for me or this cannot happen. It's a very bad intention and bad attitude. We should not have that in our mindset, and we should not preach it, and we should not live by it. Because it's a method of the devil to get people weary, to lose focus, and to take them out of the presence of God whenever trouble comes. There is always bound to be trouble. And the reason of trouble, I will let us know a little bit today. After we understand the bread and living. So I believe the Lord gave this word. When I was inquiring after the Holy Spirit, after the series of what happened in the dream, yesterday night stroke today, when I was worried there, it's not that I was worried because of my personal need. No, that was not the reason why I was down. I was down because of, I don't like to receive phone calls of trouble and everything. I don't at all. You know, when anything happened to a member, it happened to you. When it happened to somebody, it happened to you. You will not understand it until you are a pastor. So you just don't like things that are happening. You are not happy about it. And coupled with the fact to see the way people are turning, the side, I put everything together with the side people are turning to the gospel of truth in this end time. My spirit was asking God, why is the gospel like this? Why are the people like this? Why do people like the gospel of lies? They hate the truth. So, and I was receiving the answer back in my spirit that the Bible says, it was just like the way Jesus was in the garden, on the field where He was tempted. And the word was coming back to me and said, wide and broad is the gate that leads to hell. Many people go by it. But narrow is the way that goes to heaven. Only few find it. So when you get to the gate to heaven, when it says narrow, it says only few find it. Look at that English. few finds it, which means to find the truth, to locate the truth, you need to find. But the lies, you don't need to look for it. It will always come around. Lies come to look for people, but true, you will find it yourself. Do you try to understand what I'm saying? It requires your effort to find the truth, but lies always show itself to people. Lie is very cheap. Truth is very difficult to get, because it doesn't look like genuine. Truth does not look like genuine, but lie is like very fast. Everybody wants to buy it. That is what this message is all about. The message of truth, the message of lie. And believe me, these people that speak, preach the lie, they know. They know that the people love the lies. They know that that is what they want to hear. They know that it's very easy. That is where I can get them here. That's where I can get the crowd. Believe me, I am not telling you lies. In any big congregation you see in this world, in this end time, it is lies that hold people and keep the crowd. No matter what ministry, I don't give regard to anyone. Even the largest you can see that you say they can preach holiness or righteousness, I'm telling you, it's lies. That is holiness by lies. That is righteousness by lies to keep people in the place. You will see them, they speak holiness, they preach holiness, they preach the word of God. Many things happen, but it does not affect anybody in the place. Because they don't preach in the way the people will get angry, uncomfortable. They have to make it easy so that the people can stay. They are not walking according to the purpose and plan of God. Let anyone that has the highest congregation in the world stand up today and say, we need to sanitize this ministry. We need to remove every unwanted weed. We need to leave the gospel of deception. We need to direct everybody's mind to God, the Savior, the owner of this. You will see the number of people that will leave the place. You will see the crowd that will begin to leave. A man of God was telling me during last week or early this week. He said, on a Sunday, I think I was speaking to him on Monday. He said, do you know what happened on Sunday? He said he was about to go to the pulpit. He was about to go to the pulpit, and all of a sudden, the members called him. They said, Pastor, we need to speak to you before you start preaching. He said he was about to go and preach on the pulpit because it's a small church. And he said, okay. He said, everybody. They said, yeah, we want to talk to you. Then he said he sat there. According to him, he said, your messages is going out of land these days. He said, what is it? He said, the reason why we have been sitting down here, we got your message and we came to this church because you used to be very easy. And you used to take, things easy, and it was. But now, for some weeks now, you have been preaching the way we don't like. It's too tough. This is not the way we started. It was very nice and easy, and everything was like, enjoying the same party and everything. But now, you just begin to tell all those kind of things that I don't want to talk to some crazy church. the priest, that's what you want to be preaching here. And he said, but that is the truth. It's just like, he did not say this part, but I am saying it, that it's just like he discovered the truth. He said, but this is the truth, and that's what we have been missing. He said, in that case, if this is the way you have to be going, then you have to be making, some people will be making decisions. Then he said, okay, if because we are preaching that you have to be holy, then you have to be righteous, you have to change your ways, and the way you look, and the way you do things, that's why you are calling me to meetings. You can leave. Say, but if I have offended you personally, and I have offended you in my work, in my preaching, because he said because he talked too much whenever he preaches. He said, if any word that I said that offend you, I will apologize to you. I will bring you back. But if it's because we change now to be preaching holiness and righteousness and correct dressing and correct look, that's why you want to leave. You can face the door. But that has cost him a lot of drastic reduction in the member. He says it's like there's no people anymore. Now tell me, if this man, if God does, if we don't pray for him, for God to hold him, to continue holding him, he will turn back to the way he was before. You begin to go and beg and say, no, I will take things easy. It's okay. Those kind of messages you preach about wisdom, empowerment, increasing in, I don't know those topics. I don't know them. So when you begin to do all those things, you will see people that pluck hair and come to church. Hearing and come to church. You cannot address them. And some people say, why are you talking about plaiting of hair? Yeah, even if they plait it and they are changed, is it not better? But their look go along with the way they live. Believe me, it's a lie when they say, my heart is different, my look is different. They are the same. Anyone that have spirit to plait hair as a man to come to church, they will not have any good character. It's a deception for them to say, our salvation is in our heart. It's not in our body. It's a lie. They are deceiving. They just want to give you false attack. Nobody wear ring as a man in the church or do ear style in the church as a man and has any genuine salvation. It's just a matter of time. Go close to them, you see the way they live. Forget about the way they shout and speak in tongue in the church. They are never close to God. Because you can never be close to God and have, you are comfortable to do air as a man to come to church or wear it. You will remove it through the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit will make you remove all those nonsense from your head and your body. So this is a time that everybody is giving people condition. Amen.
Amen.
So this is a time, it's coming to a time that people are addressing their pastor on what to talk about. And that is what happened because they are used to all those things. And when the man wants to start changing all of a sudden to begin to seek, because the man, you know, there are sometimes you as a man of God, if there are some shortcomings, you begin to find your way small, to please God small, and become perfect even on the job. And when you begin to make changes, the member will say, this is not the way we started. You cannot begin to preach all those kind of things in the church. Some of them will address it. Some of them will call. But that is the reason why the foundation needs to be dealt with properly before a church become big. Otherwise, to change it, it will be impossible. But that is not where we are going. But I'm just talking about the things that got my spirit worried. So then what is the gospel? If people will be getting angry because they are preaching about how they can live to suit God. Some people will say, let us leave the situation of that heaven now. We are still living. Let's leave heaven. We are not dead. Let us talk about people have trouble in the church. They have problems. Let's just preach how they can be successful. If you want a preaching of how to, if you want advice on how you can sort your problem, go and see pastor after service. It's not supposed to be a topic on how you can get out of trouble, how you can get out of debt as a topic in the church. How you can like marital counseling and debt counselor and the financial analysis on the pulpit. That you can meet a man of God, God will give him wisdom to deal with that in his office or wherever after service. But the purpose of the church is to heal spiritually sick people. People need to come to church to get better every day spiritually. Otherwise, it's dangerous. In the ministry I was before, there used to be, in 2003, there used to be a woman that used to be a Sunday school teacher. Very fervent. Very fervent. She taught very well. She was the first Sunday school teacher I was sitting under her class when I joined the ministry. Yesterday, I went to Lidl to buy things in the shop. And I just saw her. I don't want to make any descriptions. And I just greeted her. She even forgot that she was me. Because it was like coincidence. He was not expecting that it was me. Say, hey! The slang she used and the way she looked like. Oh, I wanted to address her immediately and say, don't use that language to greet me again. I am not a worldly person. And I will say that language in the Yoruba because he spoke it in my language. He said, hey, Shewapa. That was the whole Sunday school teacher. And that was not the way she used to greet people before. But which means she has gone with the dressing, with the way of new life, and she had to get out of the church to go to a lesser church where she can do whatever she wants to go. So that's the way it is. When people want to misbehave, they find a easier place. Because they cannot cope with this one. Some people will say the righteousness of our sister here was telling me, during the week. There used to be a sister that came here. Immediately she came to this city, she joined us here, and later on she complained that she can't come because this place is too holy for her. That she was still going through some certain things, and whenever she was in our midst, she used to feel uncomfortable and dirty. I said, no, you don't have to feel like that. It's bit by bit, the Lord will change you. He said, you don't understand. Well, she explained in her own way, which I don't want to go into details. But what I'm saying is that she's in another place now, and the word that she passed to one of her sister is that my pastor told me, that's the new pastor, that the righteousness of Christ is enough to take us to heaven, not what we watch on TV or the way we live our lives. I said, you see, that is a great place for her. That is a mighty place. Mighty preachers, excellent preachers. Please believe me, if a preacher does not get a message from the throne of God, there is no preaching. There is no preaching. It's deception. It's a business. Marketing strategies to keep people in a place. Even somebody can be right from God. A church can be from God. But once you apply market strategies or marketing strategies to say, I need to grow, you can be genuinely from God. But once you sit down as a pastor or a minister and say, we need to grow more than this, and you now begin to design, this is what we, believe me, is finished. The calling is gone. You can still be holding microphone. There is calling and there are lost calling. People that have lost their calling, they are still preaching. Calling is lost since. Because when the calling is lost, God will just withdraw. The person might still be shouting. The speaking in tongue might still remain there because it's something that he has memorized many years. It must still be there. Even surprisingly, the miracle must still happen. But the heaven will not give message anymore. It will just be message like somebody that went to Bible school. It does not have impact in anybody's life to change any way anybody lives. And the purpose of the Bible, according to my understanding, that the Bible, Lord has given us is 1 Peter, is to change someone, to prepare someone to be rapturable in the day of Christ. That is the purpose of the gospel. That's the reason why you are in the church. The first church in the book of Acts, that is why they gather together to sharpen themselves, that they might be perfect and waiting for the coming of the Lord Jesus. It is not a place of business. It is not a place of transaction or helping people say, I just have to go there so that some people might help me and might help somebody, and we know we are together, and whenever things go wrong, I can. No, that is not the purpose of church. You see some people with different reasons. Some people say, in that church they don't help people, that's why I left. Some people, in that church they don't love. She is the one that don't love. And you think, because you remember our preaching that talks about mirror. You see yourself in anybody, and therefore you'll be complaining. Whereas you are the carrier of the trouble. When you don't love, you say people don't love me. When you don't give, you say they don't give in that church, they don't help anybody. How many people have you helped in the church? You see, it's mirror. Your character, you see it in people, and people will be getting angry at their own character as they see in the people, other people. And they'll be getting angry, they'll be having reason to leave, say this one, and I have problem, nobody helps. And whereas they live any way they wanted to live. Amen. Amen. So I used to have a member here that briefly, I don't want to mention name, a male, because you will know the person. He's still the member, it's just that he's not around. He told me, he said, do you know from the place I was before, I don't believe in paying tithe. I don't believe it. And he was here many weeks, he never put hand in any offering bucket to do anything. Because he doesn't believe in it. But it's the same person that have problem almost every time that the church will say, we have to help. Now, if we don't do that, how can we have money to pay you? To help you? If we don't. If others don't. How do you want? Do you think God will throw us money from heaven to sort all this your trouble? If you have and you don't believe in doing that. So, for that reason, it's beginning to understand that that is important. It is necessary. And where he is now, he's learning a lot of lessons that will change him forever when he comes out. Because he has seen many things. The place is necessary for him for serious changing. Thank God he confirmed it himself. So what I'm saying is, we do not live by bread alone. Otherwise, we'll be finding many reasons why we'll not be able to do the will of God. Finding reason of being born again is by living by bread. So, Deuteronomy chapter 8, 1 to 6, and verses 12 to 20.
Deuteronomy chapter 8, from 1 I read.
Yeah.
All the commandments which
I want us to listen very well. If I had my way, I want you to speak, to read it on microphone, please. They are very important Bible passages. There are about 8 of them or so, and we close.
All the commandments. Which
I command thee this day, shall ye observe to do, that ye may live and multiply, and go in and possess the land which the Lord swore unto your fathers. And thou shalt remember all the way which the Lord thy God led thee these 40 years in the wilderness, to humble thee and to prove thee, to know what was in thy heart, whether thou wouldest keep his commandments or no. And he humbled thee and suffered thee to hunger, and fed thee with manna, which thou knewest not, neither did thy fathers know, that he might know thee, that he might make thee know that man does not live by bread only, but by every word that proceeded out of the mouth of the Lord doeth man live. Thy remnant waxed not old upon thee, neither did thy foot swell these 40 years. Thou shalt also consider in thy heart that as a man chastises his son, so the Lord thy God chastises thee.
Are you up to 6?
Therefore, thou shalt keep the commandments of the Lord thy God, to walk in his ways and to fear him.
Amen.
Amen.
So you see that? The Bible says the Lord gives permission for the children of Israel during their traveling in between the Egypt and the promised land to face many things. So what the Lord does is that whenever he saves people, he makes them pass through the moment of what they call desert life. And the purpose is for us to build our trust in him. The Lord wants people, because if you don't trust him, you cannot live to please him. The trust ability increases the love ability. I repeat it. The trust ability increases your love ability. Somebody you trust so much, you will love the person. So God wants to build trust relationship between you and him. And therefore, you cannot trust him except you go through some problems. That problem, the way you pray and the problem, and the solution came, it increases one step of trust again. Say, I trust God, because he's the one that did that one, he can do this one. And as you are moving towards trust, you are learning trust, you are increasing by trust, growing by trust in faith. Your faith will be increasing and your love for him will be increasing. That's the reason why God gave permission to the trying agent and all those people that used to, the language that we used to say, this one tried me, I have temptation, this one happened to me. Those are the reasons. It is not that God wants to try anybody. The Bible says God does not try anyone, but the permission, nothing happened to anybody without his consent. Do we understand that? So our mistakes bring our trial. I want you to understand this. Mistakes bring trial. It is not God. God does not try anyone. Mistakes bring trial and trouble. But God will now come. God will permit that mistakes. God will now come to sort the problem, so that our trust can increase that he can do it. You see that now? So he doesn't try, but he gives permission for error or mistakes. Then he comes in and help and increase our love and trust for him. So that is what God made the children of Israel learn in the wilderness. But that is not that direction we are going. I just want us to understand the context. Man shall not live by bread. So because God has the ability to always solve problems does not have to mean that I have to be in the church because of that. Do we understand where I'm going now? Now, if it does not show up, then we have to redefine our relationship. God, you better begin to tell me now whether this works or it doesn't work. That is not the way it works. We are not saved because of any bread. We are saved so that we can please and love the Lord in keeping His commandment. So that our process of salvation will increase our trust, and our trust level will increase our love level, and our love level will make us to obey His commandment. That's the purpose of our salvation. It's not to receive. But when we now base and focus our salvation on that receiving level, we will never be able to accompany the trust and love level. There will be trouble. We will be spiritually imbalanced. We will be failing God every time. Because we are focused on receiving, but God wants us to be more than receiving, or to be more than a receiver. So that is what this passage is telling us. Man shall not live by bread, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. We are saved that we might obey the commandment. You see, he further explained to us there from verse 3. He said, so he humbled you, allowed you to hunger, and fed you with manna, which you did not know, nor did your fathers know, that he might make you know that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of the Lord. And when you jump now to 12 says, lest when you have eaten or are full, and have built beautiful houses and dwell in them, and when you heard with your herds and your flocks multiply, and your silver and your gold are multiplied, and that you are multiplied. 14, when your heart is lifted up, and you forget the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, from the house of bondage, who led you through that great and terrible wilderness, in which were fiery serpents and scorpions, and thirsty land where there was no water, who brought water for you out of the flinty rock, who fed you in the wilderness with manna, which your fathers did not know, that he might humble you, and that he might test you to do you good in the hand. 17, then you say in your heart, my power and my might have done this, have gained this wealth. 18, and you shall remember the Lord your God, it is he who give you power to get wealth, that he may establish his covenant, which is swore to your fathers, as it is this day. Then it shall be, if you by any means forget the Lord your God and follow other gods and serve them and worship them, I testify against you this day that you shall surely perish. 20, as the nations which the Lord destroyed before you, so you shall perish, because you would not be obedient to the voice of the Lord your God. Do you see that? So God does not take pleasure in destroying anyone in hellfire. That is why the blessing does not come quickly to children of God the way it's supposed to. God is not deaf. He can hear you. Neither is he blind to see the problem that you go through. But he wants more than what you are expecting. So that you will not be destroyed in the hand. The process of time of knowing him is to make you increase your trust level, to increase the love level, to begin to obey all his commandments. And all his effort to accomplish that, many people, they fail in doing that. All they just want is to, because if the Lord allows you to get up, and the Lord, surely, because there are some people there, actually, God, believe me, God always, God sometimes give our heart desire against his wishes. And that is why David said in the book of Psalm, he says, some of them, they asked for what they wanted, but the Lord gave them, against his desire, but he gave their heart to the leaners. Which means he gave them against what he wants, because they are so much demanding. Some people will say, I will die, oh God, if you don't do this. They will go on 1 month and 21-day dry fast. Do you know that person can commit suicide through fasting, if God did not give it? Somebody has to say, I will not eat until somebody give me a phone call from town. And he went to the mountain. If somebody does not call me from town, I will not break. I will die here. It's better to die than to... So when God sees that it's spiritual suicide, he will not say, you better... He will just call somebody, call this one and give him the money he's looking for. So phone call will come, the answer will come. You say, ah, God, I give you glory. That kind of person, when they have another trouble, they will do the same thing. They will go to the mountain again. God, because that's the way, that's the relationship they have built with God. Relationship of fasting and prayer whenever they need anything. I don't have that kind of relationship. I tell people I don't fast because I need, my wife knows. I don't fast because I need anything. If you see me fasting, I want spiritual growth. I want to hear more from God. I want to please God. Praying against any kind of trap of the devil that can take me out of his will. That's what I fast for. Other things that I need, I just say it in prayers. And the Lord takes care of them. I don't fast, dry fast because I need anything. Never. Never, because I have been in relationship with God to understand that fasting does not get it unless you get it by force. If you do fasting to get it, you are getting against God, against desire of God for you. And though you get it, those kind of people will be that kind of woman I told you about. Now that it will just, everything will just change about them. They will just leave the Lord and begin to, because they will believe that it's their wisdom that have done that. They have not learned enough. They have not been in the enough process to understand the heart of God, to live by faith. So they will think, like the Bible says here, it is the wisdom. It is I have made it. I have been successful. I have been able to do this. And before you know it, they will be forgetting the Lord. They will be forgetting Him. They will be forgetting Him because they believe they have power. And whenever things go wrong again, they will go to another dry fast. That is not a good relationship. It's not a stable Christian life. It's a life that will not never go out of trouble. If we need to be out of trouble once and for all, we need to be constant. And if we want God to use, God can never use that kind of life today, tomorrow, but a constant life that is growing daily to please the Lord. Now, some people will say, this is the Old Testament. It's not talking about, it's no longer in the New Testament. Some people might say, look, in this Old Testament, the Lord says, the reason that I've saved you is for you to keep all my commandments, to live righteously. But unfortunately, some people say in this church, in some churches in this generation, they teach their members that righteousness is only God. You don't need nobody. I'm afraid to hear that kind of thing. My pastor told me that righteousness is not anybody's business, it's only God. Nobody. And that righteousness, nobody is righteous, it's only God. And that righteousness of God is the one that we are keeping to go to heaven. So therefore, we have to take it easy. We need to relax. And therefore, they can watch any useless movie they watch, both pornography or rubbish movie where they show rubbish things that will pollute their mind and make their life, their mind and spirit begin to think about bad things. So nobody can watch any movie that is romantic or pornography that will not trouble your mind. Nobody. Thank God I was born also like a woman being. I grew up like a woman being. I have watched, when I was in sin, I have watched pornography before. I have watched romantic movies before. So as a woman being, I can tell you how you feel when you finish watching. Even for many years, for many months, it will still continue dwelling in your heart. So why do you not say the righteousness of God will take that away? How can He take that away? When you deliberately, have you forgotten the same Paul that said that? He says, how can you now, in chapter 6 of Romans, how can you dwell in sin and have the grace to abound? Never. And he makes himself clear in chapter 8 of the same Romans. You know, they are talking about Romans chapter 4, Romans chapter 5, but they are not actually talking about, they don't know that it's a letter that Brother Paul wrote to the church in Rome. And the letter starts from, you know, it's like you write a letter of many pages. You are explaining yourself from the beginning. And some people now took the beginning. They now begin to say, that is our own belief. They have not finished the letter. You need to finish the letter. It's a letter to the Roman church. Finish it before you pick one. Because in chapter 8, He said, therefore, from verse 1, therefore there is no what? No condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. He did not finish, and there are some wicked translation that finish in that place. They didn't say the rest. Have you ever seen that kind of translation? They will just say, therefore there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ, and they just remove the rest. And thank God for some translator. They said, no, it's not finished. In Greek, Hebrew, there is part, and they added that one. For those who do no longer live what? According to the flesh, but in the spirit. Thank God for those translators. They would have caused confusion in this end time. So which may brother Paul understand that when you receive Christ, it's righteousness. It's the righteousness of God that makes us to know Christ. That is what brother Paul said. Without the righteousness of God, we cannot look at God. God is too righteous to look at anyone that is living in sin. So his righteousness is the mercy through the blood of Jesus that gives us righteousness. Otherwise, we were sinners. So through his righteousness, he saved us. He said, okay, I flush away all your past lives. Everything you have done in the past, I wash them. You are like a clean slate. Now, I give you the gift of my righteousness. Begin to live a new life. I will be with you. And now, if you now leave that place, you got the power, 1 John chapter 1 verse 12, to become a child because of the righteousness of God. And you now begin to live any way you like. I have got the righteousness. I have got the righteousness. He is able to save me and take me to heaven. And you don't keep his commandment. It's a life of destruction. Deuteronomy said we must, he saved you so that we can keep his commandment. We must not live only by bread alone. And we go and check New Testament too. So the people that will say that is Old Testament. Luke 4, it is in Matthew 4:4. It's in Luke 4:4. And I just want to read it from Luke chapter 4, verse 1 to 4. Luke chapter 4, verse 1 to 4. Then Jesus, being filled with the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit. What was he doing in Jordan? What did he go and do in Jordan before he returned?
Baptism.
Glory be to God. So after he was baptized, immediately after he was baptized by who? John the Baptist. He went straight into the wilderness. After he returned from Jordan and was led by Spirit into the wilderness, being tempted for 40 days by the devil. And in those days, he ate nothing. So the Matthew said, after fasted for 40 days. But Luke said, being tempted for 40 days, which means during the fasting, the devil did not want him to finish the fasting. That's why I took it. I decided to read Luke. Now they have different story. Luke had a little bit different. Matthew had a little bit different. Matthew said after. Can somebody read that Matthew for us? I want to compare Matthew chapter 4, 1 to 4.
Matthew,
yes, ma'am.
4, 1 to 4.
Yeah.
Then was Jesus led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was afterward and hungered. And when the tempter came to him, he said, Son of God.
That's what I want to find out. Now, Luke 4 now. You see the way he says. And Luke 4 said, then Jesus being filled. Matthew said, after he had been fasted for 40 days and 40 nights. But Luke said, during the 40 days and 40 nights, he was being tempted. So it made me believe that the devil did not want Jesus to even finish the fasting. It's like you set yourself to fast 21 days. And from the, like our sister said in Sunday school, you decide, not even 21 days is too much. You want to fast in one day. And 12 o'clock, you begin to check the time and say, I just don't know. Whenever I want to fast, my legs shake. Some people will say, my tummy is just shaking. I don't know why. And believe me, the day you are not fasting, you are not even feeling anything. And you will not eat till 2 o'clock. But the day you say, I want to fast, some people will begin to say, I just have... There was a brother that came to me for prayer at that time. I say we have to fast 3 days, two of us, to see for God to intervene. And he said, you can do it, sir, for me. Because I cannot do it, I'm on medication. I said, this one think I'm a herbalist or some prophet, because it's some prophet that used to do that. I don't want to go into details. You know, you give them money and meat and bomb bitter. May God help some blind believers. They will buy bonfita. They will buy bonfita and bread and meat, and they put money. Say, so prophet or pastor, whatever they call it. So this is the money. This is the thing. Please help me do the 7-day fasting, and the Lord will be with you. And then they will go home. And they will not be using phone call, because they have deposited money and they give. They will not be using phone call to monitor the prophet. How fast, sir? God revealed anything? He said, the Lord is working on your case. The Lord is working on your case. He said, glory be to God. He then said, call, sir, are you on the mountain? He said, we are fasting. We are on the 6th day now. We are going 7 days for you, my brother. So on the 6th day, you can send some money, because we need to do a little sacrifice to give some people some things. If you can just bring some more, 20,000 to do that. That is deception. Deception. And if God will open your eyes, you see that man is eating pandan yam, that time he's calling you that they are on the 6th day. He's just eating. Honestly, it does happen. There's one Christian movie we watched like that with my wife. That man will just say, yes, in this today is 2nd day. And he's eating bread and tea and egg. And the children were looking at him on the table. He's the pastor. He said, yes, my sister, we're on the mountain. No problem. The devil is in trouble. He said, and when he finished, one of the daughters said, daddy, he said, what, are you not fasting? He said, don't mind those people. And he just continue eating his bread. It is the same pastor that will kill with fasting. You see that kind of thing. And the people believe that they have handed their matter over to the pastor to do the fasting and the prayer. May God just help some ignorant and blind Christian. Those people that look for cheap, that don't want to do things. You don't have to use anybody to fast for you. All you need to do is to give your life to be his friend. When you are his friend, you can speak to him yourself. You don't have to live by bread. You live by every word that comes out of his mouth. In obedience to his word. Otherwise, we'll just be choosing to say, this one does not work. This one, I don't have to live like this. I got Jesus Christ as my chief priest. I got the blood of Jesus to fight for me. I don't need to live any righteous life. I don't need to live in any way. His blood will take me to heaven when I die. It's a lie, destruction. After Jesus saved, he told us what we must do. You will find out very soon. The person that we are claiming to say his blood has saved us, righteousness, he gave us righteousness. He will see what himself will tell us about what we must do. Because some people will say it's the Old Testament that said that place. It's the New Testament. Now, I continue reading verse 3 of Luke. Verse 2. Being tempted for 40 days and by the devil, and in those days he ate nothing, and afterward, when he had ended, he was hungry. And the devil said to him, if you are the Son of God, command this stone to become bread. At least you are hungry. Turn this stone to be bread so that you can eat. And Jesus quoted from the book of Deuteronomy so that you can know that Jesus knew the Bible himself. He said, but Jesus answered him and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread. He said himself, the whole king of Israel, it is written. In the book of law, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. Which means there is no shortcut to anything in life. There is no shortcut to miracle. There is no shortcut to blessing. Every shortcut will lead to trouble, eternal punishment and sorrow. The only way to success, miracle and blessing is by every word of God. Anything we achieve or gain without obeying the word of God will cause trouble. Everlasting destruction. Any corner that we cut, we say, it's too hard to obey God. I just want to cut corners. They will bring more terrible. Devil does not give anything without you pay for it. Because every other shortcut is from the devil. So everything that comes from the devil through shortcuts brings sorrow, pain, disaster. The only way to get from God is through the word of God. You cannot, it's not by our own righteousness to say, this is the way I think it should be done. This is the way I want to be done. I use the case of one of the footballers that I led to Christ as example. Before he came to me to help him, he had been always trouble to get a place, and with talent, A small boy that had talent, he was just frustrated. From the age of 7, 8, he was already in the Academy of Barcelona. And with all those quality, and from Barcelona to Sevilla, what do you call it?
Sevilla.
The Spanish people, they can pronounce it better. Sevilla. From there, he went to PSG as young boy in the academy. Because those clubs will not take you unless a boy that has talent. So, but I'm telling you this, the boy that now left all the academy, he couldn't get his life together. And I told him, I said, your problem, when he called me, I said, your problem is spiritual. But you need to seek God. Not because of bread, not because you want to have a club or you want to make it. But because you want to go to heaven, you have to repent from all your sin. Not because you want to make it in the football, but because you love God. And it's a process of you, God bringing you through the moment of trusting Him and loving Him in keeping His commandment. So after preaching and everything to him, he gave his life. Do you know, before I started speaking to me, I sent the CV and video to a club. And when I was speaking in this place, because when I have emails, I do know if the computer is on, there will be a sound that will say, pow. So when I was praying for him with my wife on the phone to lead him to Christ, my email sounded, bang. So when I finished, I went straight to the computer to check who sent me. I'm telling you the truth. It was that same boy that just led to Christ. A club said he should come immediately. While we were praying for him to know Christ, the problem was taken away from him. The problem of many years not having club. And the club not only invited him, they sent tickets. They sent tickets to me to give him to come immediately. And he went there, he got there, he signed. So when he signed, I'm telling you about the story in this January. When he signed, he started playing. I said, now, you see what God can do? He said, yes, I've seen. He works. I said, now, go away from sin. God did not save you because of bread. He saved you so that you can obey His commandment and prepare you for heaven. You will not be destroyed at the end. If you go to sin again, the worst thing will happen. He said, okay. Do you know after he played about 5 matches? No, he played. So after he played a few games, he already scored 4 goals in about 5 games. Everybody was marveled. Everybody was praising him. So his head went up. He now went back to one girlfriend because they gave him a beautiful apartment. He brought that girlfriend from one country, I don't want to mention, because they brought him to the apartment, they were living in sin. I got to know, because of some trouble with the club, that he had a woman. So the club said his game has changed since he brought a girl. And we didn't know him that he's married. They said, so the president is complaining, everybody is complaining. Even the spectators that watch football, they are saying that he's changed now the way he plays. And I called and said, do you have a woman? He said, it's my girlfriend, he's the one I want to marry. I said, have you married? Have you done marriage? He said, no. I said, you have to send her back to where she come from. That is the sin the Lord is warning you from. And that is the reason why you begin to see problems. All those problems, I said, you don't play anymore. Football is spiritual. You can have talent and nobody will know you. But if God is on your side, there are 2 ways to get people. Because I've been in that business. I was there before the Lord called me. So I have seen players that go in every holiday, they go to Herbalist. They go to all those prophets so that they can get better club. So I said, football is spiritual. If you don't stay with God, you stay with some power. Those successful footballers, they stay with one person. There's no player that you see as a star that did not, no matter whether they are white or anything you call them, they must worship something. You don't become a star, but otherwise you go up, you just come down. Nobody, the stardom will not belong if you don't belong to anything. But to sustain your stardom, you must sustain it by one power or spirit. So if you know God, the only thing to be with God is no sin. If there is sin, God can no longer support you. I told him, I said, that's why you see all those trouble. He didn't believe me. He didn't send the girl away. Even up to yesterday, I called him, is the girl back? He said, no. I said, you see, you have played 11. Do you know that he doesn't score anymore? I said, now you have played 12. You still maintain the same goal you scored since February or January. Do you now know that sin is destruction? He said, I see. So why do you choose to allow the enemy to use you? Because the only thing That's why I say his problem is spiritual. The only thing the enemy can do to stop you in your career is sin. So why not leave that lady? I say, why not marry her? If that is what you want to do, why don't you go know the family, get married? He said the lady said she cannot marry because his salary is too small. When they get a bigger salary, they can do wedding. I say, you see that? So which means if you come down tomorrow, the lady can go. If you don't have any more, why sacrifice your life because of a woman that cannot stay with you for small salary? What do you call love there? That is not love. It's crazy. For you to love somebody that say you must have huge salary before you can do marriage. That's no more love there. It's money that is there. So you must define your relationship. I will not teach you what to do. It's your life. But I can just give you guiding as a pastor and as also your agent. I can just give you advice. It's your life to get away with sin. Throw the lady wherever she came from. Face God, squarely. You cannot face God with a cursed thing in your camp. You will not be able to prosper. You have enough star to play in any Arsenal or Man U, but you must get rid of sin. Otherwise, that thing will keep you until your career is over. I gave him advice and I left the place. I can tell you many of them that are living in sin, that God, through what God is doing, I preach to many of them. I can tell you another one and another one. There's even one now that sent his wife and children out and carry another young girl, a footballer. And everything is just dropping about his career. And I told him too, I said, you see, you can't send your wife and children out, carry a strange woman, and they owe him 3 months' salary, a huge amount of money. He was not calling me, Samuel, please help me. This club, help me. Can you help me? Pressurize them to pay me. I said, I will do that. But that is not your problem. The problem is your life is in sin. You are living in sin. I don't care whether I get a living through you. When you live in sin, I have to tell you. If you like, go and look for another person that will not tell you the way of the Lord. You are living in sin, you want, they will hold you even 1 year. Because the problem is sin. So we pray with him, with my wife. That one too, that's another one. And 2-3 days after they paid him everything, they owe him. And Allah told him, send that lady out. That's your problem. Because the enemy has brought that lady here, because your contract is almost finished there, and they brought that lady so that you will not be able to get another one. True sin. Go and get back to your wife. Whatever she does. She lavish money. What told you that this one too will not lavish money? Because as far as I'm concerned, the lady said, your wife told me that you gave the lady 21 million, you know, all those huge amount of money. These are young people that are just rich by error, by talent. And that thing get too much into their head and they begin to misbehave. Even the work, they don't know their agent even with the money. Because you need to be all those worldly agents to be successful like them. Those are the worldly agents that are always very rich. But as a child of God, there are everything you must make must be through the player, not in any other way. And he has to give you by percentage, naturally, by agreement. But every worldly, other people, they get it through any other means. Even including not giving all their signing fee, they will divert it to themselves and tell the board there is nothing like that. You have big salary, you get it, that one is okay for you. So what I'm saying is, righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is a reproach. God has saved us to keep us in his presence, in obeying his word. So that when we are doing that, the life will be a lot more easier. But when we pursue the bread, instead of the maker of bread, there will be many trouble. The pursuers, you're pursuing the bread will now lead into many trouble. Just like 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 1 to 6. By pursuing bread in church, in ministry, in calling, in anything, it will bring you to a lot of snare, trouble, trouble, trouble. And that trouble will now take that life finally. We don't stay in the church because of any reason. We don't accept Christ because of anything. Because if you do, that is what you are going to be after. And if that thing is not coming, that is a selfish need. And you see yourself pursuing that thing in many other places. And try to struggle to make it, to make sure that it works. John 6, 24 to 36. Just want to rush the rest. John 6, 24 to 36.
Yes.
John chapter 6, 24 to 36. That's one. Can you? John chapter 6, verse 24 to 36.
On the following day, when the people who were standing on the other side of the sea saw that there was no other boat there except that one which his disciple has entered, and that Jesus had not entered the boat with his disciples, but his disciples has gone away alone. 23. However, other boats came from Tiberias, near the place where they ate bread after the Lord had given thanks.
24 to 36. You started from 21.
Oh, I started from 22. Sorry, sir.
24.
Okay.
You are so
sorry,
good.
Sir. Mm. Okay.
It's good also because you let us know that they ate bread.
When the people therefore saw that Jesus was not there, mm-hmm. but his disciples, mm-hmm. they also got into boats and mm-hmm. came to Capernaum mm-hmm. seeking Jesus. 25. Mm-hmm. And when they found him mm-hmm. on the other side of the sea, mm-hmm. they said to him, Rabbi, when did you come here?
Hold on. You see that? I want you to see this story very well. Now, these people they are eating bread. You know, they were part of the 5,000 that ate bread and fishes. So they saw Jesus as a manufacturer of bread. Now they were looking for him with all passion. Where is this man? The next day. Where is this man? Where can we find him? Then Jesus was just looking at them as they are coming and said, look at these people. Hypocrites. You would think they are coming for real gospel. You think it's because of gospel they are looking for me. They were passionately looking for Jesus. When they saw him, they said, Master, where have you been? We have been looking around for you everywhere. What is the problem? What? Look at what Jesus told them.
26.
Yeah.
Jesus answered them and said, uh-huh. Most assuredly, uh-huh. I say to you,
yes.
you seek me not because you saw the signs, but because you ate of the loaves and were filled.
You see, he said, I know you are not seeking me because of the miracle, or neither is it because of the word of God, but because of the bread you ate. Mm. You want to eat more. I know. That's why you are pursuing me. Because Jesus was a supernatural being, he knew the heart of all of them. Jesus always knew before anybody speak. You know? Because he had the nature of God. The Bible says he was found in the same position as God. And although he did not take it for granted. So he knew all things. And he said, you came looking for bread, not for me, not for the word of God. Yes, 27.
27. Do not labor for the food which perishes, mm. but for the food which endures to mm. everlasting life, mm. which the Son of Man will give you, mm. because God the Father has set his seal on him.
Mm.
28. Then they said to him, what shall we do that we may work the works of God?
Mm.
29. Jesus answered and said to them, mm. this is the work of God, that you believe in him who he sent.
He said, all you are looking for is bread. You come looking for bread in the place of worship. We come looking for bread in the place of adoration, in assembly of the children of God. Singers are looking for bread in their singing ability. Preachers are looking for bread in their preaching ability. Members are looking for bread even in the congregation, and they want to go to a church where the bread can be given. It might not be only food that is your bread. It might be your need. I have had people that say, I need to marry. I need to be where some brothers are. You know? Why would they see me if I'm here and that old people are in? You know? Some churches where old people are there. Am I going to marry to all those old people? I need to belong to somewhere some young men can see me. And the same thing some men might say, I need to go to a church where they have ladies that I can choose from. That is their own bread. Some people say, I want to be a preacher. There's calling on my head. And therefore, they are looking for it, a church where the opportunity will be given to them. They look for the church passionately, where there's going to be opportunity of bread, according to their heart desire. And until they get there, they will not stop going to any places, moving from one place to the other, looking for the bread. Looking for Jesus that share bread according to their desire. So whatever is your desire, if you pursue it passionately more than the purpose of God for your life, you are a seeker of bread. And the Bible says, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every bit of the word that comes from God. We need to live in trusting Him, in obeying Him, and loving Him. And Jesus told them, they said, what can we do? He said, only thing you can do, you must seek for a food that lasts forever. What is the food that lasts forever? The hearing of the word of God and the obedience of the word. They do good. Many people don't know that living godly life can sort many things for you rather than fasting. I'm not against fasting. I fast. You know, the first time I preached that in the place, I didn't clarify myself. They misunderstood me. They thought I did not like fasting. I do fast. I fast. God give me the grace of fasting. But I don't fast to look for things. That's what I'm saying. I fast to seek more presence of God, to receive information, revelation, more power, more anointing, more presence of God in my life. That's what I fast for. Not for anything I want. So obedience, in other words, is better than what? Sacrifice. That's what we call, that's the bottom line. To obey the word of God is better than fasting for those things. You don't fast that you can be alive. You obey for God to be, you obey God to be alive. Because the Bible says, he that breathed what? His tongue and his mouth will do what? Will save his life from what? Many trouble. And he will live long. There are many words of God that pertain to living long. He that also respects his parents will live long. A righteous also will flourish with long life. Even in their old age, the Bible says they will still continue to flourish. Anyone that do the will of God, they have covenant of long life. So it is not by fasting. When somebody is sick, you have what you have to keep in the word of God. It is not by, people misunderstand, they say it's a self, that is not your righteousness. It's not your righteousness. It's just obedience to the word of God. It does not mean your righteousness. Because God has called us to obey Him. And it's your obedience of the word of God is to fulfill everything that the Lord says you should do. It's not by showing your righteousness. It's just by being a good child of your father. A good child of a father will obey the commandment of his father. That's what you are doing. And when you do that, there is a reward. Because he said the sickness of the Gentiles will not come upon you when you do that. You see that? So in obedience, there is many safety than fasting. Because fasting is a solution to emergency trouble that we cause ourselves. You see that? So he said the purpose of God for you is not to seek bread. Verse 29, he said, but the plan of God is that, he said, this is the work of God, that you believe in Him who is sent. Which means, He is the one that was sent, that was Jesus. You believe in His message, you repent from your sin, and you continue to live a upright and a righteous life. That is the life, that is the bread of life. Every other bread, you will come back looking for another one. For instance, somebody that is in church for one reason, or for a wife. If you get your wife, you come back when you need a child. If you get your child, you come back when you need food to give the child or the mother, when you need a job. So it is never lasting. But when you have Christ, the bread of life, it will always make provision, regular provision, smooth one. Because you don't need to apologize to come back. It's your father. You talk to him regularly. But somebody that got the wife and left, they will come back and say, Father, I'm sorry. Oh, last time I was supposed to stay. I just picked my sister. Don't let me mention sister by mistake. I just picked my sister and I went away. Please, we need a child. And the Lord will say, okay, you know, God is always merciful. He said, just like a prodigal child. He said, I'm sorry, I squandered the money. The father said, don't worry, come back home. And the other child at home was very angry. Why would they, this one that went and useless all the money and they still welcoming back home? And the Lord said, you are home. Whatever I have is yours. This is the one that has disconnected himself from my inheritance. And let us welcome your brother, bath him, and make him one of us again, where he belongs. You see, that's the way God is. God is always welcoming to make people anew and to keep them where they truly belong. That's why he called us, we have inheritance with him when we have union with him. But when we disinherit ourselves, he is not the one that disinherited us, but we are the one that chose to do that. And we went away. And whenever, you know, like a goat, Or what do they call those black goats? How many people have Sunday seen them in Africa? He or she, whatever they are, whenever they go and take somebody bread, on the those people that are selling bread outside, they hit them with. You know, goats, they are not satisfied with beating. But if you want goat not to come back again, just catch the goat. Take a bucket of cold water. I've done it before, that's why I'm saying that. May God forgive me, when I was young. So you catch the goat, you carry a bucket of water. Because if you beat, they will come back. You just throw the goat to sink properly inside it. I will not bring him out and throw him away. Oh! What? That is more than beating for him. He will enter inside the ear. He will enter the nose everywhere. You will not see him again. When he sees you, like, you he recognizes this is a wicked man. That throw me inside, he wants to kill me inside that water. He will not come again. But all the beating, they have strong body to resist any beating. They will not feel anything. But that cold water, enter body, enter eyes and everywhere, and the body, they won't pass that street again. So that's the way some believers are. May God just have mercy on us. Let me finish quickly because of time. So can you finish, ma'am? The 36.
30. Therefore, they said to him, "What sign will you perform then that we may see it and believe you? What work will you do? Our father," 31, "our father ate the manna in the desert, as it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat." 32, "Then Jesus said to them, most assuredly I say to you, Moses did not give you the bread from heaven, but my father gives you the true bread from heaven. 33, "For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." 34, "Then they said to him, Lord, give us..."
Can everybody underline that 33 in your Bible? If you have a Bible that belongs to you, that somebody else will not complain. And underline 33. "For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." That is the holy bread you seek for. Who is that person? Jesus is the only bread that everybody is supposed to pursue. Let your focus be on Jesus. He is the supplier of bread. Pastor is not your supplier of bread. He is just a disher. You know those like disciples that share. After Jesus has multiplied, disciples, they share. That's what a pastor is. Or bishop, or evangelist. But why now put all our trust in the pastor? Say, this is the man that have to do my... I used to tell people, if you are sick, lay your hands on your body. The Bible said, this sign shall follow those who believe, not pastors. I have to tell you the truth. I'm supposed to say you trust me. So that at least when you are coming for your healing, you bring one e-goat or she-goat or chicken or a gallon of oil. So that the healing can be perfected. Because if I pray and you don't bring that, perfection might be far. So I'm just joking. Amen. So you pray yourself and you begin to, God wants you to trust him with healing. When you pray for a sick person, you yourself, ordinary person, you pray for somebody and you see the healing. One day like that, you know, they were dragging over a boy that was convulsing. I was still a young believer. The boy was convulsing, they put a spoon and they dragged in the kind of place in Africa you have to come to a junction before you catch a taxi. So they brought the child, everybody on the road, they were waiting for taxi. And the spoon was still in the mouth of the baby. And I was a young believer. They crowded, they surrounded the baby. And I used my hand like this. So that if I do it publicly and it does not work, they will not say, come. So I did like this. I just stretched my hand to just make sure that he touched one area there. I did my silent prayer. And all of a sudden, before the taxi will come, the boy was released. I just quickly left the place. I didn't make any announcement or anything. So I'm not saying that it's my prayer that healed the boy. But what I'm saying is, at least I have a faith that God works through prayer. So we understand that. So God wants you to build trust in everything you do. Begin to pray for somebody so that you can have confidence that you can actually pray for somebody to get healing. Begin to preach to people so that when you win them, you can have confidence that you are able to preach and the Lord is able to win the soul. So begin to confront even sickness that is, what can we call it? You know, there are some sickness we don't like, Christians don't like to face, to preach for people. When somebody say, talk about HIV or some other thing, you just say, may God have mercy on us, my sister. Amen. And you just take a move. Because you cannot face that. Because it's a very big one that the sister might go and check and say, the prayer of my sister did not even work. And everything. All you just need to do is to lead the Christ to the healer, the person to the healer. Make sure that is only when God can work for you. If you want to pray for the French people say cadeau.
Free.
If you want to just throw away the grace of God, you might just disgrace yourself. But if you let the person connect to the healer and understand the purpose of healing, that this is just your bread. But God does not want you to take this bread to live by this bread of HIV. He wants you to live by the supernatural bread, which is the Lord Jesus. I want to show you to the bread of life. The one that can heal this pain, this HIV, and you remain permanently healed. And it will do many other things about your life that needs to be done too. That's the one I want to lead you to. Because this one is just small. You know, unbelievers that have sickness, they will rely on you when you begin to say they are sickness. See, sickness, they look big. You say it's very small. And you want to know that Jesus that said he can heal this one and still do any other thing. I said, but he does not want you to pursue him because of all this bread. He wants your life. He doesn't want to be destroyed in hell. He wants you to be repentant. He died for you. He shed blood at the Calvary because of you. So if you want to understand and believe him, because that is his purpose for you, is to believe him, to repent from your sin. It is only when you do that, genuinely from you, even if you do it fake, it will not go. HIV will not go. God knows when somebody is genuine. That somebody that says, let me just accept it, maybe this prayer will work. So when you do it genuinely, the Lord will do it. Even sometimes if you don't, the Lord will still do it to check where you go from there. Amen.
Amen.
Believe me, nobody cheats God. If God does it and you are not repentant, and you claim, you pretend, the Bible says, more terrible thing will come after them to that person, and the person will now begin to run around. No solution. I've seen people that happened to. They pretended to be born again. You pray and the Lord saved them, and they just go back. Even for when you call them, say, my sister, hey, you see them. You say, you want to ask them about how they are growing in Christ. And you say, hey, they just do run about hand to you like that. I see, we can't. That means they are no longer in Christ because the healing and all the miracle has happened. Believe me, they will come back later, no matter how long. They will come and listen to what you have to say. Yes, ma'am.
34. Then they said to him, Lord, give us this bread always. 35. And Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life.
I am the bread of life.
He who comes to me shall never hunger, and he who believes in me shall never thirst. 36. But I said to you that you have seen me and yet do not believe.
Amen. See, we see the bread of life, we don't believe. Many people don't trust. They don't even want to start to learn how to trust. Because they just want magical physical bread. Nobody can be satisfied without Jesus. There's a song, unfortunately I don't know that song. It says, who can satisfy my soul? Who can satisfy my soul? Does anybody know that song? Like you. La 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 la. La la, there is a fountain. Oh, is the kind. La 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 la. That's the song. Amen. It's a very interesting song.
Amen.
Nobody can satisfy the soul of anybody. No amount of food. If you like, take 3 rations, you will end up in toilet. But it's only Jesus that can give you lasting peace and joy, the bread that you need for life. It will make you a fisherman instead of you to be somebody that hunt around to eat fish. It will give you your own possession. See, this is how to fish it. That's why David knows that part of it. He said, he is the one that did what? That trained my hand for battle, my fingers for war. The bread of life. Seek after the bread of life, not the bread that will finish at any time. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes out of the mouth of God. Obedience is better than sacrifice. Oh, how I wish I can have more time, but the time is gone. Hebrews 10, 37, 38, two verses. Habakkuk 2, 4, you can read it at home. Romans 1, 16 to 17, you can read that home. But I will read Hebrews 10, 37 to 38, and 2, and Revelation, and I close.
Hebrews 10, 37, 38.
Yes, ma'am.
Say, for yet a little while, and he that shall come will come, and will not tarry. Now the just shall live by faith, but if any man draw back, my soul shall have no pleasure in him.
Hey, you see that? For yet a little while, and he who is coming will come and will not tarry. Who is it? Who is coming?
Jesus.
He will come, he will not be late, he will not tarry. That's what it means. He will not prolong his coming. He will come. Now the just shall live by what? Faith, not by bread alone. The faith comes through trusting God. Because when you begin to grow with Him daily, your knowledge of the Word of God is increasing your trust ability, which increases your level of faith and love for God. The just shall live by faith. But if anyone draws back, what happens? My soul has no pleasure in him. Because anyone that looks for bread and not the giver of bread, they always draw back. Believe me. When you do not have focus on the giver of the bread or the interest of the giver of bread in mind, and you are not seeking after the giver of the bread, and you are looking for the bread, you will turn back. And the Lord said he does not have desire in those that turn back. He said his soul has no pleasure in those that turn back. And those that turn back, withdraw or grow weary. They are the people. In the wilderness, you can see that when those people finish, when they exhausted the bread, the manna, you know, when they need food again, what did they do? They started making trouble again. Because after the manna, their lifestyle did not change in trusting God. In growing up, wising up to say, God is the Lord that provided. He took us out of Egypt. He's the King of Kings. Let us worship Him and trust Him alone. They did not even get that yet. Until the Lord sent them, He was angry. He said, no, these people are constantly and continuously wicked. And they do not even know what I have them to know. Therefore, I want to destroy them. Then He sent fiery serpent to begin to bite. And that one too was the purpose of seeing that whether they will still trust him. Because he told Moses, he said, put up a snake. After they have been beaten, anyone that look at the stick, at the snake on the pole, will be saved. What was God looking for there again? Trust ability. God is looking for trust since you became born again. He's looking for your spiritual growth. To trust him. To believe him. Because that is the only thing that increases your faith. And you cannot live this Christian life unless you are, you cannot be just and righteous like God wants to be unless you live by faith. It is faith that makes you live a justful and an upright life. And you cannot accomplish that unless your trust level increases in good relationship with God, not pursuing bread. Bread will reduce faith level all the time. Because somebody that is pursuing bread, God will do something today, tomorrow you forgot and you'll be crying again. As if you have not seen testimony yesterday, a miracle yesterday, you'll be crying again for another one because you are a seeker of bread. Seekers of bread always forget one testimony when they see another trouble. But when you seek and believe in the word of God, through the one that is sent, according to that 6th chapter, verse 29, then your faith level will increase through your trusting level. And that will allow you to love him, to begin to keep all his commandments and trust in him. Trust and obey. There is no other way to be happy in Jesus than to trust and obey. Trust and obey. There is no other way to be happy. When we walk with the Lord in the light of His word, what a privilege is on our way. When we do His own will, He abides with us still. Never worry, but trust and obey. And the last one, Revelation 3, 7 to 11. Revelation chapter 3, 14 to 22.
And the angel of the church of...
And to the angel of the church of the Laodicean write, these things says the Amen, the faithful...
Who is the Amen?
Jesus.
Hey. I feel trembling when I hear the name of the Lord. He has some powerful names. Amen. God says Amen. Hey! Yeah.
The faithful and true witness. The beginning.
The faithful and true witness. The beginning and the creation. Oh. Glory to your name. Worship Him. He is the Lord that is called Amen. The faithful and righteous God.
Thank you, Lord.
Oh, hallelujah to your name. Sit down, sit down. The Lord is faithful. Let's sit and finish this. He's a great and powerful God. Yes, ma'am.
Sorry, sir.
What did He say to the church? 15.
15. I know your works.
I know your works.
That you are neither cold nor hot.
You are neither cold or
nor
hot.
I would wish you were cold or hot. 16. So then, because you are lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will vomit you out of my mouth. 17. Because you say, I am rich, have become wealthy, and have need of nothing, and do not know that you are wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked.
You see, 18. Anyone that does not have Christ is this is his future, no matter how rich they can be. No matter how influential, no matter how connected, you cannot. This is the kind of word I used to disqualify those footballers that I have. Don't get money to you because you are wretched and poor and miserable if you don't have Christ. No matter what you carry to bank every week or every month, you are nothing without Christ. Many of them go to church. They are lukewarm. They are not connected to any socket of the church. They don't feel anything in their body in the church. They just go, they come, they sit down, they pay. Even some of those followers, they pay tithe. Like this one I told you that left the wife. They pay tithe, they carry money to church, they do everything. They do things like religious people. But they are not connected to heaven. They don't have any socket. And they are as miserable, as wretched, and poor and blind. The only rich people is the ones that have Jesus. You don't know what you have. That's why you think some people think they are poor in Christ. You are not poor. It's just because we are not utilizing our weapon rightly. Anyone in Christ is richer than anybody. Because you actually have authority in your mouth to bind and to loose anyone. Anywhere you receive, it's not stubbornness or pride. When you need something, you have the right to say, please, this thing needs to be done with all respect. Otherwise, I have a God that can find. And when He does, He can remove anybody in position. I'm telling you, He can. I don't have time to tell you an example, but I just go on to finish because of time.
18. I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in the fire, that you may be rich, and white garments, that you may be clothed, that the shape of your
nakedness. What is the gold refined? It is Amen that is saying that. He said, I reckon you to buy a gold refined from me. And what? What white garments?
White garments.
You see, gold refined is your salvation. I reckon you to buy the free gift. You don't need money. I'm going to give you free. buy it from me. He used the language buy, otherwise, on the contrary, it's free. And white garment, that is your righteousness, righteous living. So that's all you need to be rich, not all those things you pursue after. Yes?
That the shame of your nakedness may not be revealed, and anoint your eyes with eye salve, that you may see. 19. As many as I love, I rebuke and
as
chasten.
As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Yeah?
Therefore, be zealous and repent. 20. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in to him and dine with him, and he with me. 21. To him who overcomes, I will grant to sit with me
on my throne.
As I also overcame, it came and sat down with my father on his throne. 22. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches.
You see, he overcame. He was the first human to overcame, although greater than human. But he was made in the image of man so that nobody will have an excuse to say, I cannot do this. That's why he was born like every other person. And he said, since I can overcome, there is no reason for nobody to overcome. There will not be excuse on that day, the day of judgment, for the seekers of bread. Seek not bread alone, but every word that comes from the word of God. He has called you to buy his gold, to be clothed with a white garment, to repent from our ways, to remove yourself from the midst of people that pursue bread, provision, prayer chasers. You know, if we don't buy prayer books or everything, we are not happy. We just want to buy different kind of prayer books because we think we have many problems, but we are actually the cause of the troubles. Believe me, show me any trouble, I will tell you where they come from with the help of the Holy Spirit. But the total obedience of God brings you out of every trouble in life and gives you a peaceful life and joy. Anyone that overcome, you don't run away, you overcome. For instance, you say somebody, these people are like this, and you run away from there. You have to overcome it. How are you going to test that you are actually overcome anger when you run away from people that are making you angry? How do you want to complain that you overcome hatred when you are running away instead of you to show people how to love? How will you tell people that you overcome arrogance when you shy away from understanding that you are actually arrogant and you need to change? When people say, sister, this is arrogance, come on, go, oh brother, hey, what is that? And you use arrogance to even prove another reason for to be arrogant. We must overcome, subdue sin before we can be glorified beside the Lord Jesus by his throne in heaven. Everybody will be tempted, will be tried with those sins that we say we are running for. If you want to show that you have overcome lies, the lie situation will come and keep you in the corner. Believe me, it will come. If you are a child of God, you say, you overcome lie, okay. Devil will be there and say, when the father will say, this is my daughter, she doesn't lie, she can never lie. Devil will say, okay, father, give me a chance to try with one lie. You saw that in the book of Job, isn't it? And the devil will come. He say, okay, with all permission, I give you. You go there, catch you in the corner, and the child of God will say, no. He say, you see? It's because you provided an environment around him not to lie. Or around her not to lie. That's why she's holy. Let me try. I know my tricks. She will begin to lie now, you see. And as soon as the devil created that opportunity, you just see a child of God begin to say, no, it's not. And you will not leave. You say, oh, God. The devil will not be smiling. I told you, God, that and another person might be hunger. Oh, God, I give you glory. You saved me from hunger spirit. I have overcome. And the devil will say, overcome? You overcome anger. Okay, Father, we need to try. Because anyone that I overcome needs to be tried. So let me try him or her. Now the devil comes. Somebody just comes. Believe me, devil know what makes you angry. That thing that you cannot resist. Somebody will just do it. Say, what? You have to say, oh God, I forgot I am a child of God. I'm born. I forgot I was a child of God. Oh, look at the shameful way I behave. The devil will just be smiling in the way. Father, I told you don't have many genuine children. They are all like me. They are all like me. You know, the way I used to pretend. They are all pretenders. Nobody can prove that you overcome anything unless you are try and overcome. Jesus was tried with everything and he overcame everything. That is what we read now. 40 days, 40 nights, temptation overcame. But anyone that seek after bread cannot overcome anything. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Anyone that seek after bread cannot overcome. They will always be pursued and taken by the passion over the bread they are seeking. And therefore they will always fail. Because seeking bread might not only be what you want, it might just be your pride. I'm looking for my pride. I'm looking for my protection. I'm looking for my interest. I don't want to lose anything. I don't want to lose relationship. I don't want to lose happiness. I don't want to lose money. I don't want to lose commission. You know, look at the way I told you that I spoke to those footballers. They are the, even in this time, they are the reason why, they are not the reason why I'm living, but they are the reason why I have some money in my pocket. But that does not mean that I will not say the truth. Because if I withhold it, and the devil will begin to smile and say, you see, you just had your son, pastor, something. It's because of the bread you want to take from that boy, he cannot speak the truth. He now begins to dodge and manipulate. He will just be laughing. But I understand that area of him, of the devil. I will say, no, if you like, then go away, look for another agent or manager. That is the truth. You must do it. You must do it. If you don't want to do it, it will be recorded that I've told you the truth. And I've told you that God is against it. So everything that we try to do for alternative, they are the bread that we are pursuing. Our interest, our passion, our favor, what we want to gain in anything is our bread. Watch out. The last one, Revelation 7:3, 7 to 11. Revelation chapter 3, the same chapter, 7 to 11.
And the first beast, Revelation.
Can I read it, ma'am? Thank you, because of time. And to the angel of the church in Philadelphia, that's 7. These things says he who is holy, who is holy, he who is true, he who has the key of David, he who opens and no one shuts, he who shuts and no one opens. I know your words. See, I have set before you an open door, and no one can shut it, for you have a little strength, have kept my word, and have not denied my name. Indeed, I will make those of the synagogue of Satan, who say they are Jews and are not, but lie. Indeed, I will make them come and worship before your feet, and to know that I have loved you. 10. Because you have kept my commandment to persevere. You see, you persevere through keeping of the commandment. The Lord knows what you are doing. Any child of God that is struggling, you know, it's not easy. In pain, in agony, in perseverance, you keep the word of God. The Lord knows. He said he will reward you. He will set a gate before you that nobody will be able to close. He will set a gate and will close all those troubled doors. Nobody will be able to open it. In the mighty name of Jesus. Because you keep his commandment and you persevere. I also will keep you from hour of trial, which shall come upon the whole world, to test those who dwell on the heart. 11. Behold, I am coming quickly. Hold fast what you have, that no one may take your crown. He who overcomes, and we make him a pillar of the temple of God. A star from death. Hold on to what you have if you have really found the bread of life. Hold on to it. Persevere. Don't let anything take you away. Don't let fear make you do something against the word of God. Don't let devil can bring fear to make you lie. Devil can bring fear to make you think, this is going away from me. But in perseverance and speaking the truth and staying in the hand of God, the Lord knows what you are doing. Hold on to what you have if you are finding. And if you are not, begin to think and begin to repent. I don't want to be among the chasers of bread. I want to have the bread of life. I need to do the will of God. I don't want any small trouble to make me scary and fearful. I want to stand and remember your faithfulness in anything you have done for me, to give me more courage to move on. When you begin to do this, you become stronger and stronger, and you begin to live by faith as a just man and woman. Rise up on your feet.
You are the Alpha and